Welcome back to Slow Unpacking, where we will take our sweet time. Magic the Gathering is a game, but for me it's more about story. I love watching unpackings of cards. Who doesn't want to hear the satisfying crackle? Well, this is nice, but I always find myself pausing the video between the cards to try to look at them. So I thought, why not just pause the video for myself? This way I can unravel the story together with you. This is Slow Unpacking. Nexus Wardens from Dan Scott. Flavor: the summer Nexus is a holy grove in Setessa, where the starfields of Nyx glitter in the shadows. We see satires, usually all about having fun, now being very serious about protecting their grove. We can see the starry glitter of the stars of Nyx between the trees. Setessa is the polis where Karametra, god of harvest, is honored, though Karametra does endorse other gods to be honored in each of her nexuses. The summer nexus is made in the name of Iroas of Victory and Nylea of the Hunt. These archers with reach are probably mainly aligned with Nylea. Sunmane Pegasus from John Severin Brassel. Flavor: chosen by Heliod, Daxos approached the Pegasus without fear and rode it without saddle or reins. Riding a horse without saddle or reins in the air, that is faith. When we look at this art, we see how wide aligned this card really is. The clouds and the Pegasus almost blend in with the frame. In John's other work, we see other characters, small but very important movement, and often the clouds framing the picture with a mood. This one is not very different. Rage Scarred Berserker from Antonio José Manzanedo. Flavor: the fury of the slaughter god Mogus burns within him. The god Mogus is a Minotaur himself, and all of his followers seem to be cows, Minotaurs as well. Maybe these followers are onto something. Mogus is the red and black version of the black and white aligned Iroas. Mogus is surprisingly enough not endorsed by Karametra, like in the previous card. Maybe that is why this guy is so angry. He wants to play in the Nexus as well. I would not want to live in this barren place either, so I do get where he is coming from. Eidolon of Philosophy from Adam Paouette. And what did Aragustos teach us is the nature of the soul. Our first enchantment creature is an avatar of philosophy, which is just an idea and is not strong at all. If you do put a lot of energy into it, you might gain some knowledge, but that's a far stretch. I love how this idea is wearing philosopher's clothing and the book as well. It is even pointing upwards, exactly like Socrates does. Aragustos from the flavor text is mentioned nowhere else, but his thoughts must not be very Greek either, for they believed the soul was immortal. This soul of philosophy is to be sacrificed. Nyxborn Courser from Bastien Deharme. Storms drove them westward to Skophos. White plains shimmered in starlight. Centaurs greeted them, offering gold-hued apples and grain cakes from the Calathea. This is just a 2/5, but also our second enchantment creature. This card exists for being an enchantment creature, but we can see different things as well, like how these beings, made by gods, were open-hearted towards visitors. Does this mean that gods like humans sometimes? The Book of Calathea tells us about how the demigod guided some people towards different lands. It does not say why or who exactly yet. The story goes on with: one-eyed and frightful, the Cyclops lifted a boulder and hurled it seaward from cliff's edge, shattering masts and scattering sailors from Nyxborn Brute, and storm-tossed and broken, Calathea cried out to deep-dwelling Thassa. Tritons came swiftly to save her, bringing her north to the Lindes from Nyxborn Seaguard. Nyxborn Marauder from Steve Prescott. Flavor? Calafi guided them into darkness of Hedos, the bleak mire. Bloodhorned Minotaur circled them, axes a glimmer in shadow. Another vanilla creature that is an enchantment. Now for black. In this case, I don't think that these beings like humans. So gods do also hate humans sometimes. This also exactly defeats our courser from before. Maybe the gods' hate is a little bit more impressive than their love for humans. The story of the Calafia ends with 3 tall giants confronted her, fiercely demanding her tribute. Fox cunning, Calafi's slippery speaking entangled their senses. From Nyxborn Colossus. And Calafi gazed on the coastline, certain her destiny called her here, where the mist-shrouded rocks sang, promising glories undreamed of, from unknown shores. Ichthyomorphosis from Campbell White. Tycthis's military career was a flop. This fish seems to wear a helmet. I want to start off with that. His friends do not seem to mind his business anymore even. They just march on as it seems. Now, his way too hard name already sounded like fish, so he really had this coming for a long time. Irreverent Revelers from Milivoi, Ceran. Flavor, to some satires, only blasphemy is sacred. A very red card where freedom is explained by blasphemy, the act of defiling the sacred. Here we see the less serious part of satires, where they just want to destroy everything that has rules or form. This is their religion. In this time, I would love to party like a satire again. Look at the shocked faces of the crowd. They must relish in the discussion as well. Relentless pursuit of Magaei Villeneuve. Flavor, Calix was patient, steadily following Elspeth until their destined confrontation. Calix would always find his targets, because it was destined to be so. Although some beings do seem to elude him, like Elspeth or Lady Nico as well. Or perhaps he will find them later, now that he is a planeswalker. Magaei makes lovely, string-like textures of hair, fire, and oh my goodness, the hair is so good. I am glad that she got to make the strands of faith itself here. I think she was destined to make this one. Sweet Oblivion by Clint Cearly. Flavor, when memory is torment, oblivion is bliss. This is a good motto for when I forget my keys again. Losing the top of your head means losing your memory. This is something that we can learn from Ashiok as well. Though in this case, the picture does still seem grueling. But also some playful puppy colors are to be seen, which I like. I do not endorse milling though. Skophos, Maze Warden by Jason Rainville. This card is the first card that doesn't have a flavor text on itself. But it does have some flavor in the ability as well. This says a lot about the set and how much there is to be told about it. This is a card that is paired with the Labyrinth of Skophos, linking to the older stories of Labyrinths and Magnetors. This dude has found his target, and if he is anything like the Minotaur god of Rage, he will attack him as well. Jason's work is often very intricate, but what I love about his work the most is how honest his characters are. They could be real, like a full-bellied pirate admiral, a surprised apprentice, or a very proud pet owner. Wait, is this coincidence? Calafi, beloved of the sea by Zack Stella, is a demigod, loved by the sea and probably by the sea goddess Vesa as well, although they do not necessarily synergize all too well in this case. We have seen her 5 minutes ago in her story of the Calafia. So she was a famous trickster, helped by Vesa and lured into new adventures by the sea. Apparently the sea likes smart tricksters. That does sound sea-like. The Acroan War by Steven Belledin. A first saga, very well made, and the first tryout with a creative way of telling us how the people of Theros tell stories, which is in this case by tapestry. This story tells us about a very well-known war that many movies have been made of by now, where a queen in this case switches sides, taunting the king and then the king being trapped by the enemy. It's the Trojan War. Planes and then also foil planes by Sam Burley. Sam made these very unique lands all in one painting. I personally love that these are all from one painting of the sky. This is also interesting because it suggests that mana comes from lands, but also from stars in Theros. What could this mean for future lands? Next time you look upon the stars, think about the power they may grant you as well. Wall token by Adam Paouette again. This wall shows us some of the blue-white architecture of Theros. The colors remind me, personally, of the colors of Athens, which is a very Azorius-aligned city as well. The fact that Adam made the Eidolon of philosophy and then a wall in a city that was all about knowledge is funny as well. If you look at his other artwork, it is all very aggressive nature swooshing and swirling around the canvas here and there. And here, the city is a set in stone version of these swoops and swirls. People on Theros have really captured nature in their architecture. Thank you again for watching, and if there is something else that you would like to see, or there's something that you'd like to see, or maybe you have a totally new idea, then of course I am open to hear it, and I probably will answer pretty quickly. So thanks again, and we'll see you again next week.